Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please?
Are you ready?
Yo, what up, what up? It's your boy Rabino.
And this DJ Erm in the building.
And you listening to the Up and Up podcast.
Yeah.
Wait, what are we doing?
I don't know, just listen.
Yes, 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 yes. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
What it do, what it do?
Ladies and gentlemen, you're tuning to the Up and Up podcast. I'm your host, Rabino.
I'm DJ Erm, man.
DJ Erm, man. What's going on, man?
I'm good, man.
Good?
Yeah, rested, feeling good.
Yeah.
What about you?
You got a little power nap in earlier?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. It's Friday night. I'm feeling good, bro. Feeling good. It's Friday. Blessed. Highly favored, right? Mm-hmm. Shout out my guy, Abdi, back in the building. Can we get a round of applause real quick?
Yeah.
Abdi back in the building. Main camera guy, man. Shout out to you for coming back. Also, thank you for those of you first-time listeners out there who are tuning in for the first time. This is the Up and Up podcast. This is the podcast where we focus on cultivating culture. We do that by providing amazing stories of, you know, individuals, groups, movements, people who are out here just really carving the lane, man, you know? Not just for themselves, but for people who are coming behind them, right? also want to shout out, you know, you got to shout out the consistent supporters, listeners, viewers, right? They've been giving us some love, man.
Yeah.
Some real, real energy, real good encouragement, man. So shout out to y'all. For those of you who want to continue supporting this podcast, you know what to do. Make sure to rate, review, subscribe.
And like it,
and
too.
Like it, too. If you don't like it, Erm's going to get mad at you, so just do it. you can find all the episodes on YouTube, SoundCloud, and iTunes. Just type in the Up and Up podcast, and that's where you can find it. Also, please, please, please make sure to follow us if you're not already, @_TheUpAndUp on all social media platforms. A lot of great things coming for 2019, right?
Yes, sir.
Right? I'm inspired, man. I get inspired by just seeing what everybody in the city is doing. Everybody out here in the region is doing, so be on the lookout, right?
Yeah.
Also, upandupclothing.com.
We still here. Yeah.
Yeah, man. Go get your gear, man, and stay on the Up and Up in style. You can follow us @_UpAndUpClothing, or you can visit the store, www.upandupclothing.com, right? Mm-hmm. I got it right this time,
yes,
right?
Yes, sir.
Staying on the topic of the store, obviously, if you have been tapping in with the platform, you know that we are doing a free ticket giveaway for anybody who's made a purchase on the store between May 13th all the way up to July 31st to go see who. Tickets to go see who, man?
Nas, man. The legend.
Nas, man. It's 25-year Illmatic anniversary. It's Nas. It's AZ. And who else? They just announced this like 2 weeks ago. Who else?
Lupe,
yeah, yeah, man, Lupe Fiasco. So that's
that's some legendary shit.
Yeah, man, that's.
I know my boy's opening up for him. I think my guy Redhead.
Okay, at that same show.
Yep.
Okay, well, shit. Yeah. There you go. Yep. And Redhead gonna be up there too,
yep,
man.
Yep.
Now, so make sure to go to upandupclothing.com to get your tickets or to enter for your chance to win tickets. Is that it? We good?
Yeah.
You got anything?
Nah, man, I'm good, man.
All right, get straight to it.
Let's do it.
All right, man. Well, if you are a first-time listener, let me just tell you how this goes, man. We always bring a compelling story up here. You know, we bring people up here who are really going to just drive inspiration, motivation, right, through storytelling and through telling their story and their journey. I would say today's guest is a man whose elevation and transformation is what really is making him one of the hottest and most committed rap artists out of the city of Seattle as well as the Northwest region alone. I would say he's a driven and committed talent who's keeping everything he's doing on the up and up, right?
Yeah.
Obviously, otherwise he wouldn't be with us tonight, kicking it, right?
Yeah.
He's also here today on behalf of Bag Records, as BAG, Bag Records, and his entire team. Man, just to help drive conversation that'll keep cultivating culture, right?
Yes, sir.
Let's just get straight to him, man. I'm ready to rock. I'm ready to rock. Everybody here is ready to rock.
Sure.
Our guest is none other than the man who's always in his bag.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? You know I'm going to come with it.
You got all the punchlines today.
You
feel me? Yeah, you got
come
all
on. I'm not a rapper, though. Always in his bag, man. Mafi D, can we get a round of applause?
Yeah.
Welcome to the show, brother. How you doing?
I'm good, man. I'm straight.
Yes, sir. So we usually start the show off with a quote of the day, something to kind of get the vibe right, set the tone. He's the guy who does the quotes, though.
Yeah.
I'm not allowed to tell quotes on this show. It's cool.
You can't, bro. You just got to ask, bro. All right. The quote of the day today is, without continual growth and progress, such words as improvements, achievements, and success have no meaning.
Who's that by?
Benjamin Franklin.
Mm.
Gotta do it for the bag.
I need to get up on my literature, man. I need to start reading more. I like that quote.
Run it back for the people in the back, man.
For sure. So, without continual growth and progress, such words as improvements, achievements, and success have no meaning.
Mm. So it's like, I love that quote because it's really.
You gotta
really
walk
like,
your talk.
There you go.
Yes, sir.
You can't just talk
about
it.
That's what I get from it. You gotta walk your talk, man. Mm-hmm. If you're just talking about it, but you ain't actually putting forth effort, then it really don't mean nothing.
Yeah,
you know
exactly.
What I'm saying?
It's all cap. Like, you just. Really.
Yeah.
Now, obviously, you kind of get it. We bring in the quotes, obviously, because they're good quotes, but also ties into the journey of our guests.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, you're doing a lot, man. You've been moving, you've been consistently pushing content, pushing your way of the culture forward. But I also want to make sure people understand when they listen to these episodes, it's really about, we really want to talk about context to the success, right? Like, not just your wins, but also what it took to get to those wins, right?
Mm-hmm.
So let's talk a little bit about kind of your upbringing. Where'd you grow up and how did that,
up,
how did that kind of work?
I grew up in the CD. So I grew up in the Central District of Seattle. You know, a lot of people, if you know about that area, but it's totally different now. You know, because all the gentrification
for
and,
sure.
like, nothing from when I was young, nothing is the same, honestly. Like,
it doesn't exist.
Yeah, it really doesn't exist no more. You know what I'm saying? It's kind of like, I'm never ashamed about where I'm from, but it's just like, if I'm explaining something to somebody, I can't say, go there and
it's hard to tell a
go
story.
To that spot.
Yeah.
Because it's not there.
Yeah,
you know what
I'm
saying?
Yeah. It's hard to tell a story when they're erasing your story.
Exactly.
When they're erasing your history. You
erasing
know what I
mean? Everything. You know, like, my grandma just, like, they've been trying to get her to sell her house, and she finally sold it, you know? So it's like, I'm 23. I'll be 24 in August.
Mm-hmm.
So that house that she sold is, like, my whole life, you know
wow.
what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
my whole, it's
childhood,
right
yeah.
smack in the hood. Like,
wow.
I walk up the street and all my partners is right here, you know what I'm saying? I can walk outside and all my partners, you know what I'm saying? All my niggas. So, when she did that, it's like a piece of me left, you know? Like,
that's real.
It was weird. It's weird, you know what I'm saying? Like, there'd be days when, like, I wouldn't even want to go to the hood, but my excuse to go to the hood would be, let me go to my grandma's house. And now it's like, ain't nothing for you know, it's like ain't nothing for me out there.
Yeah,
you know, in a sense it's like it's a good thing.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because it's like you always want to outgrow the hood. You know what I'm saying? If you
for
really
sure.
want to be successful.
For sure.
But at the same time, it's like it's kind of bittersweet.
You want to have that place that you call home, you know, that like you can go back to and reference certain parts of your story. Cause that's essentially how you came up, right? Like you want to be able to be like, yo, I didn't just come from what you're seeing now.
Yeah.
I came from this. Yeah. And this is, you know, there's a lot of things that are tied to that. But let's talk about, you know, growing up in the Central District, right, for you. Like, what were some things you I guess, experienced that kind of shaped your outlook on life in terms of like, yo, this is kind of how I want to move. This is kind of how I see myself.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, you're 23 now, but I mean, at the time.
I'm like, me growing up in the city. I kind of like it kind of made me big on just being thorough and like tradition, you know what I'm saying? Like when I was like there was a lot of like tradition, like things was like placed in, you know what I'm saying? There was a pecking order, you know what I'm saying? Like there was things placed in order, like just, you know, from kids to being a, you know, adolescent to being a teenager, just being an adult, like like even with like just events, you know what I'm saying? Like the Rip the Cuts. I don't know if you guys heard of Rip the Cut. What else used to go down? Bubbling Brown.
I think they still do that though, right?
Yeah, they do, but it's watered down.
Yeah,
everything's
watered down.
Everything's so watered down now, you know what I'm saying? But I say that to say, like, you know, just growing it taught me tradition. It taught me to like I say, always be, you know what I'm saying, prepared, you know what I'm saying, always be prepared for the worst, you know what I'm saying, always be, you know, on my 10 toes, you know, because a lot of, you know, everything wasn't sweet, you know what I'm saying, growing up in the hood, you know, I mean, it's much different now, but, like, the things that I went through, the things that I saw them for a reason, you know, now that I think about it, and, like, I'm grateful for it, but, you know,
that's a real perspective, though.
Yeah.
Like, because, you know, I think growing up, you go through a lot of shit, and sometimes it doesn't make sense in the moment. So to look back, I think that's why it's important to always reflect and look back on. We were talking about this last episode. Like, a lot of times we dismiss a lot of shit we go through as kids. Like, oh, I was just a kid. But it's like, a lot of that shit still exists.
Yeah, it's still relevant. You know what I mean? You know, and it's still going on, you know what I'm saying, as an adult to this day. So, yeah.
Yeah. So, like, what was that moment when you was like, man, I'm about to be a rapper? You know?
Man.
It's a real moment. Just looking in the mirror, it's going to happen.
Yeah, I'm going to be real, man. Like, so, there's my nigga from the hood. His name's D-Valley. Mm-hmm. So, you know, niggas just be in the hood every day. Just, you know, some days when you ain't got nothing going on, like, nigga might be in the hood on some bullshit, just might be on the block. You ain't really making no money.
Yeah.
But, you know, you brought a group of niggas, nigga, you might start freestyling or something. You know what I'm saying?
That's like, just, that's like, part of the
just being with niggas.
Right.
You know, you might start freestyling. You might, you know, kick some shit or whatever. And then, it just, you know, niggas, every time I do it, niggas would be like, dawg, you should take it seriously, you know?
Yeah.
But it was different for me because I actually knew somebody from my hood who I could rub shoulders with and who I'm seeing doing it.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm seeing them go from, like, this nigga on the block every day or in the hood every
day
to this nigga moving around rapping, coming to the hood with CDs and,
wow,
you know what I'm saying? So I'm seeing this shit.
It's like a demonstration. You can, like, okay, someone's actually doing what
you know
everybody's
telling
me I should do.
Exactly.
Yeah,
so I'm seeing it. So I'm like, man, fuck it. Why not?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Why not? Why? If he can do it, I'm like, I can do this shit too. So
that's big, though, because that's a good question, too, because I think a lot of times we might, like, notice certain talents we have. And I think there's a difference between knowing you got a talent and then actually nurturing that talent, right?
So, and it's always better too, like you said, to have a demonstration.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
Sure. Yeah.
Because like if you're trying to if you can't tell me, you can't tell somebody not to sell drugs. You growing up in a house full of drug dealers. You growing up in a house full of crackheads and users.
Yeah.
And you don't want them to sell drugs.
Yeah.
You want them to be a lawyer or a doctor or something, but they don't see that.
Exactly.
Yeah.
This isn't what they see, so that's not what they're going to view as a success.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So for me to actually see it, it made it believable.
That's real.
You know what I'm saying?
That's real.
Yeah, so I feel like if I wasn't able to see that, I'd probably still be doing music, but it probably would have took a lot of more trials and tribulations, and it probably would have took me harder to grasp onto it a lot longer. Mm. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
For sure.
That's big, man.
For sure.
It's big to pay attention. And I think... Especially,
I don't mean to cut you off.
No, you're good.
But like at the age that I did grasp onto it, like it could have been a turning point for the worse for me. You know what I'm saying? For real.
Yeah, and I think shout out to the homie and also one of the guest contributors for the Up and Up, Rajon Stelly. Shout out to my guy. I just graduated from Eastern Washington University too. He did a story on you on the Needle Drop, and that was a really great piece he did, and in it. It did discuss about kind of your early obstacles, right? In terms of being in that environment, right?
Yeah.
Not because you wanted to, but because it was kind of something that was just surrounding you, right?
It was just
you want to talk a little bit about some of those obstacles? Because I think there's people who probably are going through that today that could probably draw from that.
I mean, anybody who grew up in the hood going to go through the obstacles, you know, a peer pressure.
Yeah.
Feeling like you getting love where it doesn't exist.
Mm-hmm.
You know, wanting to be accepted, you know, feeling this, you know, when you're a kid, I feel like from the age, from like, I say, from about like 13, your early teens to probably like 18, 19, you want to be involved. It doesn't matter what you're involved in. You just want to be involved.
Yeah.
You want to be known for being involved. It doesn't matter if it's good or bad.
Yeah.
You know, so I feel like, if you're growing up in the hood or, you know, in an environment where there's a lot of pressure on you to be a certain way where you can't, like, in the hood, I feel like anybody who's in the hood, like, they're not really being themselves, you know what I'm saying? Because you got to put on a different face in front of a whole bunch of people who you view as something different, you know what I'm saying? You guys all might be the same, but when you walk outside, you guys is putting on this extra exterior,
that's
you know
real.
What I'm saying?
That's real.
So, yeah, man. That's what I was going through. You know, I feel like that's what a lot of young men go through when they grow up in the hood.
Yeah, and I think it's having outlets though, man. You need to have outlets to express yourself in different ways too.
Yeah, you gotta have outlets.
Yeah, that's important.
Like you were saying, it's important to see like the demonstration. You know? So it's like, cause that will make you be like, oh yeah, this shit's possible.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So,
and the only demonstrations we got was shit. abandonment. You know what I'm saying? Just, it was just the wrong shit we was being shown. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That I was being shown. Yeah. You know, mm-hmm. And like for me, I had my father though, but he been locked up all my life. But like I had him in my ear. You know, like I would talk to him on a daily some days. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So I always had him in my ear, preaching to me the right things.
Mm. Yeah.
But it's different when you're seeing something, when you're seeing it, and you're on the outside and you're living it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So and like I don't care what nobody say, like your peers have more power over you than your parents do, because this is who I'm around all the time.
That's
like
real.
You know what I'm saying?
That's real.
And if I know that you're down with whatever you're down with, I'm your closest partner, I'm down with it too.
And at the end of the day, there's only so much your parents can relate. They're from a different generation.
Exactly.
You feel me? So
exactly.
You're gonna be influenced. Like there's so many invisible influences out in this world that we don't even know about. I'm reading a dope book right now, Invisible Influence by Jonah Berger. So anybody who's interested, read that. But yeah, no, that's real though. That's real, man.
So like, who are like your early like influences as far as like music? You know how like we look at like Kobe, we're like, oh yeah,
early influence.
Whatever.
I used to be heavy on the, like early when I was rapping, I used to be heavy on the Bay Underground.
Yeah.
So like I was heavy on like the Jacka. I was heavy on Filthy Rich, Joe Blow.
Okay.
Lil Blood, HD, like that whole underground scene, like the Bay Area, the mob scene, like I was heavy on that. Mm. So like my earlier tracks, it would kind of like sound a little bit mobbish, a little bit Bay. You know what I'm saying?
That, you know, you probably felt like that was the sound at the time.
At the time, the time it was, and then I was like, I don't know, like I felt like I outgrew that.
Mm-hmm.
I outgrew that a lot. You know what I'm saying? Not to dumb that down, but it was just like I was going through things, and I was starting to see a lot of people saying how Seattle really didn't have their own sound, and Seattle doesn't have, like, their own lingo, their own genre, and we're always copying somebody.
Yeah.
So that kind of swayed me to be like, man, fuck that.
Yeah.
I'm not about to sound like these niggas.
Yeah, you don't want to feel
that. Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. I'm like, nah, like you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, the Bay in Seattle, like, nigga, we distant cousins, but I'm from the 206. Like, I'm not ashamed of that shit.
It's crazy, though, because it's like, I think if people really know hip-hop, like, a lot of sounds are just influenced by other sounds too, you know.
Right.
I think you may be influenced by
you take bits and pieces from everything,
and then you create your own.
Exactly.
And I think that's big for you to notice that, because a lot of cats probably be like, man, if I could just sound like that, I could probably get in and get accepted with them, right?
You don't want to do that because it's already done.
Exactly,
it's already being done. You don't want to be known as the Filthy Rich 2.0.
Yeah,
or every time you walk in the room, they say, you remind me of such and such.
Yeah.
And it's, and everybody who says that, they don't know each other.
Mm.
So you're like, damn, what am I must really, I got to switch this shit up. You don't want to be known as the nigga who sounds just like, or looks just like, or dresses just like. You know what I'm saying?
No, that's real.
That's real, though, because people appreciate originality, you know? So
you gotta be
I feel like that's important.
The game is a little different now, though, too. Like, just hip-hop in general. Because I think, like, you know how they say, like, a lot of, obviously, the South is just kind of like it's killing it, you know.
Yeah.
And like, you got New York artists who now are making music
Southern artists. They're coming back up, like
because
New York and the East Coast, that's like where hip hop like originated, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and they're coming back around, but they're coming back around with a different sound. Like
at
first, like the East Coast was big on like being lyrical.
Mm-hmm.
And having substance, but now they're coming with the auto-tune singing
vibe, the
little TJs, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, they're coming back around. The South is definitely doing their thing, too.
I think we're in an era now where it's like, man, just make the best music, you know? Mm-hmm. I think at the time, the regional boundaries...
Don't box yourself in.
The regional boundaries didn't matter back in the day. Like, we talked about this. If you were to put me on an artist, like, back in, like, 05, the first thing I'm thinking about is, where is he from?
Yeah,
because then I can compare it to like another artist that came from there.
Or you might not even listen to him if he's from a certain certain city.
Like Bryson Tiller, he's popping, but he's from Kentucky.
Right.
And at the time, if he came out like 05, like Kentucky.
Right. And now it's like the thing. Like when you ask somebody where an artist is from, and you never heard of nobody coming out that city, you're gonna be more prone to tune in because you're like, okay, I ain't never heard nobody come like
he might be the one.
Yeah,
because
there's so many artists coming from so many different places.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? That's talented.
Nah, that's real. Now, I also want to talk to you because I think you got a lot of experience that you can probably share and learn or teach. There's a lot of people who are probably aspiring artists, right? People want to get into the music industry. For you to make that full-time commitment as a rapper, obviously, we can always have one foot in, one foot out, regardless of what industry it is. But for you, what were some things that kind of kept you disciplined when maybe, you know, out the gate, you said, okay, I'm going full time, but then maybe things may have probably pulled you back and whatnot. For those people who are struggling with that, what are some things you think they could do?
For me, what kept me disciplined was honestly the feedback that I was getting. And I would do a track, or like before I even dropped any album or anything, I had did two songs in a not really a basement, but I did two songs at like one of my older partner's house, and I had put them on some CDs, and it was two CDs, but it was only two songs. Okay. You know what I'm saying? Okay. So I had them, I made them or whatever, and I hopped in the car with my niggas. And I popped them in. I'm like 16, 17. I popped them in. And these niggas was riding to this, like, riding to it like it was somebody else. Yeah. And I'm talking about bitches and everything. Yeah. Riding, slapping it. My niggas calling me talking about, bro, somebody done stole the CD. So I'm like, damn. Like, you know what I'm saying? So I'm 17.
Yeah.
I'm hype.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm doing this shit. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So I feel like if you can get to, like, that's where it started for me. Like, my close friends, my niggas, like my peers, if they can believe in me, then I feel like I can get the whole world to believe in me. So that's important, if you can get one person to like or bob your head with that shit, then just keep doing it.
That's real.
Did you like pop it in like, this is my shit, or did you just play it?
I popped it in like this was my shit because before I started doing it, I would tell my niggas, like, I was like, bring it up to get feedback.
Yeah.
Like, man, I think I might start rapping or something. Yeah. You know, and niggas be like, shit, nigga, do it. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Well, so when I did it, I hopped in, you know, hopped in the car, like, bro, I finally did it. Popped it in. Niggas, they was on that shit.
Nah, that's rocking. Big, man. That's rocking. Big, bro, because I think you made a great point where it's like, you got to be able to use the people that are closest to you, like for support, for energy,
for
you
as
know.
Long as you can use them, because they ain't not everybody you start out with is gonna be around for the long
haul. I always say this: one of my favorite ways to describe it is there's people that watch you grow, and there's people that grow with you.
Right.
You feel me? Like, you might have one of your friends who's probably he's not trying to go down the music industry route, but he can still grow with you.
Right.
He can still be tapped into to your evolution, how you moving. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So I think that's a major lesson. Look around you. Look who's closest to you.
Yeah.
And notice who's growing with you and who's just watching you grow. You know what
exactly.
I mean?
Exactly. Or you could even expose, like, the homies to different aspects of the game that they might want to dive into.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, managing or just whatever it is.
Yeah,
you know,
like,
what I
mean? Web designing or...
Yep.
Like, I got, like, my little cutty right now, like, he came around. He's like, bro. He's like, I know you be rapping. Whoop-de-whoop-whoop.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, man, I'm thinking about going to school for web designing, bro, because we need logos and we need this and we need that. Mm. And it's like, I got him on the mind frame of, like, of being a collective.
Mm.
Yep. You know what I'm saying? And like, he raps too.
Yeah.
But like, he always tell me, he's younger than me, you know? And he's like, bro, you got the juice. He's like, you're the one.
Yeah.
He's like, I want you to be out there in the front. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
But he's like, bro, I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do this, and we're going to do this. And it's like, I watched myself go from people around me who I always had to motivate and encourage to having people around me who's on me.
Mm.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So.
That's real. That's real. I think sometimes we can get so caught up in our own pursuits, you know what I'm saying, our own visions, our own dreams, that if we actually stop and look at the progress we made, we could actually look at some opportunities that we can create for others,
right?
Which is dope, man. Like, I always think of Nipsey Hussle just based off like his upbringing and how he came up, and like everything was like, it was all money in, but it was also like, I'm gonna keep my squad tight and I'm gonna give everybody jobs.
And that's kind of like what I always tell my niggas, like when I be riding with my niggas and shit, cause like I got a lot of people who rap and who want to do music, you know, and I be telling them niggas like, nigga, use me. Like, this is what I'm here for. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's I'm your partner. Like, nigga, I'm your nigga. Like,
that's real.
Not even just with the music. Like, just call or whatever. You know what I'm saying? If I don't got it, you don't got it. Let's put our heads together. Let's figure it out.
That's real.
But the ones who want to do the music, I be like, nigga, if you don't, nigga, you talking about you don't know how to do this, know how to do that. Nigga, I do everything, nigga, damn near on my own.
Yeah.
I mean, I got a manager who we just linked up probably a couple months ago.
Yeah.
But before that, like, I had to sit down and get on the computer and learn everything, how to distribute on my own. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I'm like, nigga, if you don't call me, pick up the phone.
Yeah.
Ask some questions. You act like I'm going to be like, nah. Like, nigga, you my day one.
It got to be halfway. Yeah. Like, you got to be a self-starter, too.
Yeah, but at the same time, it's like, I'm not going to hold your hand, bro.
That's real.
You know? I can't.
Facts. Like, I'm 100% with that.
Yeah.
I'm 100% with that.
I'm pushing. So I'm going to continue to push. But I'm like, nigga, I will put you, not necessarily put you on my back.
Yeah.
But nigga. Grab this ladder that I'm about to throw. You feel me? Grab this goddamn ladder.
You got legs, bro.
Yeah, like, come on, nigga. Like, come on, dog. Like, I'm not about to leave you out here to dry, my nigga. Like, we're not about to do that.
Yeah.
You feel me? Just trust in what I'm saying. Like,
I think what's real is like, and there's not a lot of people who have that mindset, because there's a lot of people who are like, what can you do for me?
Yeah.
I agree with you. I want to see more leaders, right? So you're trying to build more leaders, it seems like.
Yeah, I don't really want nobody to, like, I don't want to be, like, the nigga that, I don't want to be the nigga that gets leased off of. You know, I want to be able to, like, okay, bro, I'm going to sit you down, I'm going to show you this, so you can go do this, so you ain't going to need me.
You're not going to be dependent on
you. Yeah, you ain't going to need me, because I'm going to be over here doing this. I'm not going to always be right by your side,
that's
bro.
Real.
You know, so whenever you need to drop this or drop that or drop that, like, okay, let's figure out a marketing plan. Let's figure out how to get this cover, whatever we need to do. Let's figure out what we need to figure out. But at the end of the day, you're not going to depend on me to drop that.
That's real.
You feel me?
I feel that.
But when I do show you this, nigga, pay attention. Because this ain't about to be an ongoing thing. You know what I'm saying?
Real,
like,
though,
I'm your nigga. Like, use me, but don't take advantage of me.
There you go.
You feel me?
Exactly.
That's real.
That's what I'm saying. I think you just got to put
people
in position. And then you can't. You got to teach them how to fish. You can't really fish for them all the time, you know?
Hell no. Yeah, hell no, because they ain't going to never learn nothing.
Exactly.
You know? They ain't going to never learn nothing at all.
Preach it, man. That's
for real. So what was, like, one of your most, like, memorable moments in music? Whether it was, like, something like a dope show or, like,
car ride?
Or where you, like, learned a lesson or something,
man,
you know what I mean?
I'm going to be real. My most – I got, like
– I know you got hella, though, but, you know.
I want to say my – I done got like 3 songs played on Cube 93, bro. No cap.
That's real.
No cap.
That's big.
No cap.
That's big.
No cap.
How'd that feel hearing your song over the airwaves like that?
What? How did it feel? Man, listen. Never in a million years would I ever would have thought I'd be doing anything or being on no radio. You know what I'm saying?
Real.
Never.
That's real.
Never. And now it's like I wouldn't say I got ties, but it's like I'm building these different relationships. You feel me? So it's like now it doesn't feel so meaningless. You know, like there's down days whenever you, not even with music. Like if you pursuing any type of career, if you're an entrepreneur and you're just going for it, like there's gonna be down days. There's gonna be days when you feel like you can take over the world, and then there's gonna be days like I'll be at home with her and I'd be like, babe, I don't even feel like I don't want to do this no more. You know, I don't even feel like I got it. You know what I'm saying? And then there'll be times like that when you get a direct message like, hey, we about to take some music. You know, we're going to play it on Cube. And then it hit. You know what I'm saying? And then, hey, we're going to play this track. And then it hit. Hey, we're going to play this other track. And then it hit. Yeah. And it's like 3 back-to-back. It's like, okay. I'm putting myself in rooms that I ain't been in yet.
Stay down. The game gonna test you.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? So
that's real. Yeah. Now that's real. And part of I think another memorable moment, I think you could probably speak about it, was I know you representing Bag, Bag Records. How did that come about? Like, how did that movement start?
So y'all know about Bag Clothing.
Yeah, for sure.
And me and him, he's older than me. He's like a generation above me. But me and him, we're from the same neighborhood. So I was just fortunate enough to know him.
Yeah.
And, you know, to being a young nigga from the hood, having a certain level of love and a certain level of respect.
That's real.
You know? So basically, you know, he had to deal with his trials and tribulations, you know what I'm saying? He had to go do some time.
Yeah.
And the time that he was serving time was the time when I had was coming out and getting into shit. Mm-hmm. Like, before that, we still knew each other, but it was distant. Mm-hmm. So, we knew each other.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
The time that he was doing time is when I was getting out into the streets and doing this and doing that. Mm-hmm. So, but I always knew, I always looked up to him because I always knew what type of guy he was and how he moved and how he handled business.
Exactly.
And, you know what I'm saying? What he stood for.
Exactly. That's important.
So, yeah, for sure. So when he got out, it was kind of like, I always knew him as somebody for getting money. And like when you're in the streets, there's only two types of niggas in the streets. You know what I'm saying? There's niggas who always want to be in the bullshit and there's niggas who want to get money.
That's real.
Mm-hmm. And when I first got into the streets, I thought the bullshit was cool. You know what I'm saying? But then I started taking a turn, and I'm like, fuck. I'm seeing this. He's shining. He's jeweled up. I'm over here in the same fucking shit every day on the block. Yeah. I don't want to go home.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I don't want to hop in the shower. Yeah. I'm not doing shit. Yeah. I want to be on the block, trapping, whatever. You know what I'm saying? I'm seeing this nigga. He's having money, but he's still looking nice. He's dressing nice. He's driving a nice-ass car. Like, nigga, I'm not about to be out here with you niggas not doing shit.
I want that.
Yeah, that's
real.
You know what I'm saying?
I feel that.
So what I did was I tried to start gravitating towards the niggas who was doing something.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, they say, like, if you wanna be something, you gotta kinda like mimic who you admire or try to get up and around somebody who is doing what you wanna do.
That's facts.
So when he got out, I was going through my case, so to say, you know, and I had ran into him. We exchanged numbers, whatever, on some bro shit, and you know, we was just kicking shit, popping shit with each other through the phones, just checking up on each other, how you doing, type shit, and like just on and on, you know, our relationship progressed, and when he got out, he had started up the clothing line,
okay,
you know, and I had to get on federal house arrest, so I really couldn't go to no studios to do no music. And I had some money saved up, so I'm like, man, what the fuck can I do to still stay in these people's faces?
Yeah.
So I'm like, fuck, I'm about to start selling T-shirts and hoodies, you know what I'm saying? Because I'm seeing him do it, so why can't I do it? Demonstration, you know what I'm saying? So I invested in that, and shit, it actually worked out for me. Like, I didn't think people was going to buy into it, but people actually started buying into it and shit like that. I gets off house arrest, long story short, back doing the music, real tough, like, and I'm just seeing him, and the more serious I got with music, the more I started learning, I'm like, man, I need a manager for this shit if I feel like I want to take this shit serious, you know?
Yeah, hell yeah.
So, I try to go to my uncle, because I'm like, first and foremost, I don't want nobody around me who I feel like is going to fuck me out some money.
Doesn't have your best interest.
Yeah, don't got my best interest, so I'm like, I don't give a shit. What resume, I don't even give a fuck if you don't know nothing about management. I don't care if we got to sit down and figure this shit out together.
The most important thing
to me is loyalty.
That's real.
You know what I'm saying?
That's real.
That's the most important thing to me. So I hit him and was like, bro, you ever thought about, you know, managing? And shit, he was like, bro, I ain't going to lie. He was like, bro, I done thought about it. You know, he was like, I done thought about it a lot. You know, I do want to get my hands, because he would hit me and be like, bro, I want to get on the track, bro. You know what I'm saying? Like, he would hit me and be like, bro, how do I do it? Because, like, he's like, you know, he ain't no rapper or nothing like that. But he was like, bro, I want to do a song, you know?
But the fact he's seeking out to you for
information. Exactly, and I'm his little bro. So
exactly.
He's like, bro, you know what I'm saying? How do I go about it? I'm like, bro, I told him one thing. I said, pick a beat. I said, and write a full song. Do the song. I said, and listen to the song over and over and over again until you can. Cause I told him, I said, you might not like it, cause you're not gonna like your voice, cause you haven't found your personality on the track. You know what I'm saying?
That's real.
I said, do one full track and just listen to it, and then let somebody else listen to it and see how they feel about it. You know? But he ain't never did it though. He ain't, you know what I'm saying?
It's never too late.
You know. But so I had told him, you know, I asked him, and he was like, bro, yeah, you know, I done thought about it, but you know, I got a lot going on right now.
You know, he
got his clothing line, and you know, he got his fam, you know, and his kids he got to raise. So I respected it. So I proceeded to do, you know, just do my thing.
Do your thing.
But he doubled back and was like, bro, you know what? I believe in you, bro. He was like, bro, let's do it. Let's sit down. Let's figure it out. Mm. And then the rest is history.
Wow.
Yep. That's so powerful, before that, man. There That's wasn't real. Before that, there wasn't even no bag records. Like,
yeah.
He went and did the whole LLC and made the bag records. So we just starting from the ground up.
Man, that's a powerful story, bro. Because I think, I don't know, man. We live in such a fast paced environment now, an era where it's like people think a lot of this shit that they see is done overnight. Like it's just
nah.
Like it's like he, pushing like, a button.
Like
you
he'll
know?
Tell you like he didn't know one thing about being a motherfucking manager.
Yeah,
you know
yeah.
what I'm saying, but. It was like, we believed in each other, you know what I'm saying?
That's important.
That's the only thing that mattered, because I'm like, I know that he's not the type of person to fuck you over
mm-hmm.
on no type of business,
yeah.
no type of bread.
Yeah.
And he know I'm the type of person that I value my name.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I value not being the type of, like, you can leave, and there might be some money on the table. Some you leave. I'm not. I value not being a nigga that's gonna touch that.
Mm-hmm.
I'ma look yeah. away. I'ma leave that room.
You got morals. Cause
if something's missing,
yeah. Yeah.
I don't want to even be around. Yeah. I don't even want you to think that I'm the type. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. yeah.
That's so
real. That's real.
Yeah. That's the most important thing, man.
Yeah, man. But I think you just gotta put your people in position, man. Like uh-huh. I was talking to the homie the other day. We were talking about this like a couple weeks ago. Remember we were talking about the management and how like a lot of artists. They, like you said, they seek out people who have resumes or who may be connected to so-and-so or this radio station or this artist.
I wouldn't recommend it.
Yeah, it's like, dog, at the end of the day, you can't create loyalty. You can't buy that shit. You know, that shit's earned. So, like,
mm-mm.
that's priceless. That's intangible.
That shit got to come from the heart.
All that other exactly. shit you can learn, bro. You can figure it out. Like
yeah, exactly. Like, he can, like, and that's what he's doing. You know,
yeah,
like, man. We can, like, shit, I had to figure out how to rap. I had
yeah.
to figure out how to do a lot of shit.
Yeah.
Like, you can sit down and figure out how to manage.
Exactly.
But you can't figure out. If you got to figure out how to be loyal, then
yeah.
that's just not the type of person that
yeah,
you are.
Yeah, it's tough. It's tough, especially nowadays, man, in today's music industry.
Yeah. So, like, what kind of, I would say, what kind of mark are you trying to, like, leave on the game? Like, what kind of legacy?
I'm trying to do some Nipsey shit.
Mm. yeah.
That's real.
I ain't even going to cap.
No, that's
I ain't going to cap. Like,
that's real.
Like, before I really didn't know, but I always knew, like, I want to do some big shit. But
yeah.
it's like, he's somebody I would want to model
yeah.
my career after. You
yeah.
know what I'm saying? Not even just with music. Like, just with being a human and with being a good person.
Yeah.
The
know?
Values.
The
yeah.
value. Yeah,
yeah.
I want to be more than a musician,
yeah.
bro.
And I think that's important that you're saying that and you believe that. Because
yeah.
I think you can provide value, right, through your music and your art.
Right.
But it's like the one thing that separated Nipsey was he understood, like, I'm not just this
yeah.
piece of art that people are consuming. But I
right.
can utilize this piece of art to do
right.
other things, right? To
mm-hmm.
affect other people and other lives. So that's big, man. I do want to talk about, you know, I always do this when we got rappers up here, bro. I'm always going to pull, like, some lyrics, right? Because I always
yeah.
want to kind of get, you know, your take on it, the yeah. artist's take. This is a song that I think you put out end of last year, Mental Health,
mm-hmm.
right? Now, powerful record, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
Really powerful record. I loved it.
Appreciate
it. So... The line I wanted to pull from here goes, can you check on me? I don't really feel well. What's wrong with me? Do I need mental health?
Mm-hmm.
I carry this pain shit well. I'm going through a lot, but you couldn't even tell,
mm-hmm.
right? I think it speaks volumes on the surface, but I think the topic of mental health is so, like just taboo. Nobody talks about it,
yeah.
especially, you know, a lot of artists.
Yeah.
And to make that kind of like your song and to title it that, what kind of went into that process?
Shit, man. I went to the studio. I just had a lot of shit on my mind.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to the studio and I had the beat. I had found the beat. And I didn't really know what to write about.
Mm.
I felt like I was forcing it. You know what I'm saying? Like, I felt like I was trying to write about some shit that somebody else might want to hear, you know?
Mm.
So then I sat back and was like, fuck that. I'm about to just write exactly what the fuck I've been going through. Like, I'm about
yeah.
to write down exactly what's on my mind.
That's real.
And shit, I finished that song in probably like 10 minutes.
Mm. It was real though.
Damn. Yeah.
Like,
yep.
I think that's what stuck out to me. Like, I mean, the topic of mental health is one thing, but then like to hear someone speak about just kind of your own personal experience, and then what it does is it makes me think about my own shit.
Right.
Right. Like, I think when you hear that song, you're gonna look back at yourself
right.
and think about, like, have I checked myself?
Right.
Right? Am I good?
Right.
And I think that's just a big topic we like to push on the show and on
yep.
the platform. And I think it's you know, it's not really spoken about a lot.
Yeah. Not shit at all.
Yeah. Yeah, man.
For real. So I know you kind of mentioned it right now, but how do you deal with, like, writer's block? Like, how do you get over that? Like, if you ever have it.
Writer's block. Man, I might. Me, with writer's block, if I have, say I start a song on a certain beat and I'm writing.
Yeah.
And I'm stuck.
Yeah.
I'll turn on a different beat.
Oh, okay,
and,
yeah.
And, redo and write a whole new song. So I have hella unfinished songs if I catch writer's block. Because I really don't, because a new beat.
Yeah.
You'll say some new shit.
Exactly.
Some different shit.
Got to.
Yeah. You'll come off the top of the head with some whole new shit. You know what I'm saying? Instead of just being stuck on this one beat. And then it's like, if you don't got no music, one day you might be in the studio with no music. You can think, okay, then I can go back to that. Mm-hmm. And once you go back, then your brand will be refreshed. Yeah. Then you'll have a lot more shit to say.
So you kind of have to be patient. That. You got to be patient, man.
Yeah, for sure.
You can't force it.
Because I know Nipsey kind of talked about it in like in Young Nigga.
Uh-huh.
And he was talking about how, like, you know, he kind of had that bar and stuff. Yeah. He was like, he's in the studio and then they slap him in his face.
Uh-huh.
You know, and he's just like, damn, you notice that you great. You know,
it's
kind of like,
for sure.
I just like to hear how, like, people deal with that. Different artists and stuff, you know. So, yeah, that's one I never heard, though. Yeah. Just throwing on a different beat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's crazy. Because most times you feel like that's going to distract you from what you're trying to do. But that's real.
No, because, I mean, shit, you know the work's there.
Yeah.
You know it's there.
You gotta give it time to
breathe, yeah.
You know?
Yep.
That's real. That's a natural that's a natural process.
Yeah.
I like that.
For sure.
Now I also want to ask you this, because I think we talked about this before the show, like how it's the Seattle music scene has really been picking up steam, man.
Uh-huh.
Like the last, I don't know, few years or so. But for you, obviously you're within it, right? What is kind of like a vision you have or see for the Seattle music scene, like moving forward, or do you have one?
The vision I have, I just feel like Seattle just needs to pick up more on their locals.
Mm.
You know, I feel like for as many artists as we got in Seattle, there's too many people with platforms or growing platforms that are too out of touch.
Mm.
And that are, you know what I'm saying? I really don't know what the fuck is going on, you know? And shit, that's just the truth. I feel like, you know, I hope one day that the locals will get more exposure.
Yeah.
You know?
I think it's due for. I think it's going
to
happen.
It's starting to come around for sure. It's starting to come around.
I think the dope thing about not having so many regional boundaries in hip-hop is, like, now there's not as many gatekeepers.
Mm-hmm.
You feel me? Like, nowadays, it's like we're kind of like the SoundCloud era now, where it's ain't no all white dude like, man.
Or if you savvy as fuck on that social media shit, you can blow up yourself.
Exactly. And then you can bring it
everything.
Back.
Yeah.
And then you can bring it back, you know what I'm saying, and put people on and put people in position. Now, we always like to give our guests a chance to kind of talk about things you got coming down the line on the horizon and whatnot. So, I mean, obviously, I'm assuming more music is on the way.
Yeah, for sure, for sure, man. I got a couple things on the way. I don't know. Me and my guy, Ralphie Davis, we're supposed to be doing a project together.
Okay.
Me and Louis from MKF.
Yeah.
We about to do a track.
You're out of Tacoma, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Out of Tacoma. What else I got going on? Potentially, I might have a show. I think July 19th for Joe Moses or RJ.
Okay.
But I'm not too sure. We're going to see how that plays out.
Okay.
What else I got coming, man?
I'm excited for those joint projects, though.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. Those are going to be hard. I got shit. Yeah, that's about it right now.
Okay.
That's about it right now, for sure. Working on another project.
Yeah, man. Know? I think that's a dope thing now. It's like, you always going to be cooking, right?
Yeah, for sure.
And you can always just release it whenever, too, right?
So
it's dope, too.
Yeah. I got shit I can release right now, but it's all about timing, though.
You want to play right now?
You know?
And also with Bag, I know you guys probably got some plans and stuff like that.
Yeah, man. That's probably the best situation that I could possibly be in.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because it's all about building.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's all about building, man. Like, if I probably be feeling used and abused, or I probably be feeling like somebody's trying to take advantage of me if I'm working with somebody who's probably working with 6-7 different other artists, you know, like in my career right now, I would need somebody who's just like, I'm all in with you.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I'm all in with you, because it's like, shit, my foot ain't even in the door.
Yeah, that's important, man.
Yeah, it's like my foot ain't in the door. I still got a lot of things on my bucket list that I got to do within the city limits.
Hell yeah.
That I ain't did yet. You know, but I'm an artist. I feel like there's a difference, man. You're either a rapper or you're an artist.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I agree.
A rapper is just somebody, you know, like any nigga can rap. You can rap. Everybody in this room can rap. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? But an artist is a rapper that knows the business, or that's learning the business.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And that's not boxed in.
That's true.
You know?
You got to own every part of your craft, bro. Yeah. You can't just be a creative.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. And I think at the end of the day, man, you nowadays more than ever, you just gotta keep applying pressure, bro. You know what I mean? You gotta stay committed, stay on it, right?
Yeah, for sure.
Keep hitting them with them records. I love the videos too, man. Do you have the same dude who directs your videos, or do you kind of mix it up?
I try to mix it up a little bit, you know what I'm saying? But I try to, but it gotta all be quality though. Like, I can't have like a fire ass music video that looks like it belongs on MTV, and then go to somebody else who look like they shot my shit on an iPhone or something. You feel me? Like, I can't do it. Yeah. You know, and a lot of people, like, there's a lot of artists in the city now who feel like they don't get their just due, and they feel like they feel like they're underrated.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And shit, it's all about, like, you can, and they're hard workers, you know what I'm saying? Like, they work hard as fuck, but it's not about the quantity that you put out. Like, that shit gotta be, like, if you gotta look who's running. You gotta look who's hitting the ground running. You gotta look and see, like, this is what that shit's looking like. That's what my shit gotta look like. If my shit ain't looking like that, I'm not putting shit out.
You got to study the market.
Or if my shit ain't sounding like that, or, like, where did he go to record that shit to get that shit sounding like that?
Yeah.
That's the studio I need to be in.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
For sure. That's how you got to think about it. That's right. Might have to spend that extra dollar, and that goes back to believing in yourself and betting on yourself.
Yeah, investing in yourself. That's real, man. Dropping gems, man, for all you rappers out there. Now, we always ask this question to kind of cap it off, something we kind of always ask our guests to kind of sum up all we talked about, and then also kind of like catch what's ahead. So if you can, what's one word to describe what keeps you on the up and up? And you can kind of explain it too, if you like.
One word. Kids.
I think that's self-explanatory. Yeah.
For real. Yeah, my kids, man. My kids, they keep me on the up and up for sure. I can't be a failure, man.
That's real.
You know, like, at first it was, you know, it was kind of, when it was just about me, it's kind of like, you know, whatever happens, happens. Mm-hmm. But at this point, it's like, what I want to happen needs to happen.
Mm.
Yeah.
You know, and it's going to happen. Real. You know?
Yeah. Power of the mind, man.
Yeah.
It's strong.
Hell yeah.
I love this, man. What for you got? You got anything else?
Where can people find you on social media?
Yeah,
on
let
the
them
web.
Know.
You can look me up Instagram, Mafi D Click Up, MAFIDKLICKUP. Twitter, the same thing. Snapchat, the same thing. You know,
pressure coming.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah,
hey,
for
man.
Sure.
Well, you know, thank you for coming to the show, man.
Appreciate it, bro.
We definitely appreciate the grind. We appreciate your demonstration and what you're doing out here for the culture. For the music scene in Seattle as well, man. And you got our support. You already know that.
Appreciate it.
With that being said, I think it's safe to say Mafi D and Bag Records are officially members of the Up and Up. Can we get a round of applause? Yeah, my guy.
Sure.